Oscar Couturier. Very fabric of life is his canvas. The threads of creativity are his tools. His every thread evokes beauty. And every silhouette tells a story. A man who defines style and influences the fashion trends of an entire nation.
And we've taken an entire central room where you can actually see the garments, the accessories and everything on a kind of a museum style setting on mannequins. Okay, can you go to the first slide, please? I think so. Are you going to come and sit here? No. So one thing for sure, the first time it makes an appearance, this Pano Bhaju appears somewhere around the vicinity of Margao, because we don't see it in the north of Goa. I never saw one in Maputa, I never saw one anywhere. In fact, I first saw it on the lady when she dressed up for us for the photo shoot that was done for Mother Goa. So I'm going to go to the next slide, please. So this is Thelma Kasta Garcia from Margao, and this is what the Pano Bhaju looks like. It's got a jacket which is normally velvet. It comes in red or green or even blue, and the embroidery is done in gold. Now in the part, there are many parts to this garment. Inside she's wearing a white lace kind of blouse, or white blouse which has got crochet on one end. Then she has a jacket on top of her. Then the skirt is like a wrap. It's like a sarong wrap, but it's very slim. And then on feet she wears what are called chenilles, which are velvet slippers. On her shoulder she carries a kind of a dupatta or a stole which is anchored to the brooch. So this is how the garment looks. Very elaborate jewellery is worn to dance this mandap. They always carry a fan in their hand. And the jewellery is put on in great quantities. They have a fakor, which is a green stone with a pink coral stone on the side, and it is a very, as you can see, a very elaborate garment. They have different versions of the Pano Bhaju, but I'm going to stay with this version. There are some versions where the Pano Bhaju was worn at home, and those were made of cotton. Some people of this generation who still have the Pano Bhaju, they said they would even wear it to go for the different versions, one to go for mass, one to go for a party. But this was the one that was used to dance the mando. Now, as you know, the mando appears suddenly out of thin air, not even in Goa, it starts in Bombay, where they started composing mandos in the very late 1800s, but more in the 1900s. So out of the mist comes this music and the mando and the pando. Okay, we'll show you different versions. Next slide, please. So that's how it looks from the back. It has these big bands of gold that run across it on the skirt section. And the top, as you can see, the jacket is just the right length, which the Portuguese could appreciate because they didn't want to show a midriff. As you, for those who have read my book, Pano Goa, you know that they put on so many impositions on dress in the Portuguese time. There are many, many dictates in the Inquisition that pertain especially to dress. They didn't want them to, they wanted us to technically forget about our Indianness. No sari choli were worn at that time, so all those wearing a sari had to cover their entire self with a white, like a sheet called a hole or a nasa. And the Inquisition imposed many rules that said you can't do this, you can't do that. Brides were told, can you imagine, we were Hindu. Brides were told not to wear red color, you had to wear a white color. But what happened, we still somehow maintained and kept our traditions with us. When the bride comes home the next day, she met what is called the Pakuna. She actually comes to her father's house in a red, either dress or sari, and they call it a tamle kapo. Now that they would not take it from us because they were not going out on the street and getting married. But everything else, whether it was wearing the bangles are still worn today by the Goan Catholic brides. They break them and they get widowed on the coffin. And all these traditions, somehow we surreptitiously could manage to hoodwink the Portuguese and get our way in the end. Now, this garment, if you can see on her hair, that she has those hairpins, right? We see them later on, they will come in the presentation. Next slide, please. So as you can see, very beautifully decorated. There were a lot of hair ornaments, which the Goan Hindus still wear quite a lot. That fakor which is on her neck, big square coral stone. For my museum, I had to hunt and finally managed to trace one in London and paid a big amount of money. But we have a large gold collection in the museum that's going to open next year. year in 2018. So, and then as you can see, there are multiple rows of gold. That topic will also come up again during the presentation. Next, please. And that's how she looks when she's sitting down. Extremely elegant garment. I don't know how many of you have seen the dancer mando, but it's done in the timing of almost like a six step in the French, almost minuet kind of fashion. Next slide. Here you can see the chevelures on her feet, also embroidered in gold, and the skirt edging can be seen more clearly. Next please. And lots of jewelry. Always lots of jewelry. From the bangles to the rings to the fan in the hand as a kind of an accessory. Next please. So I'm going to now take you on a journey which starts in Japan. In Japan, they had these kimonos, which we call kimono. And if you look at the name of the panbaju, it has three or four names. They call it bastaro or abbas and kimono also. Now, where does this kimono story come from? We actually don't use the kimono at all in the panbaju. But what we do use are the stitches and the motifs. So next slide, please. So can you see these stitches? They are all long and short stitches. This long and short stitch comes to us from three places on the planet. It comes from Japan, it comes from China, and it comes from Iran or Persia, the old Persian Empire. Now we employ these kind of stitches on the embroidery, but today we do them on a cart. In the old days, they actually did it by hand with real gold thread. Next slide, please. Again, this recurring motif of the fan and the flowers, which play an important part later on, we see. But this is a Japanese influence. Next slide. So, this is the Parsi Gara. You know, there were many Parsis that lived here in Goa. Some of them were involved in the opium trade. In fact, you all know the story of Roger Faria from TV. When the Portuguese, there was a vacuum in the Portuguese Empire, because in 1908, when Napoleon's army was threatening to take over Lisbon, at that stage the British had a treaty, and they tell the Portuguese king, Don John, you please come with us and we'll sail you all to Brazil. So the entire three shiploads, they take the mint, they take the library and they take everything and they go. Of course, the poor Brazilians were shocked to see them, because one of the ships which had the ladies on them had a case of fleas, so they shaved them all and they appeared bald, and they didn't want to appear bald, so they dressed themselves like, you know, African turban style or whatever. Not only that, they were only used to seeing their royal family on coins and on portraits. And as you all know, they cheat when they give you portraits, they make it look better. So when this very ugly royal family comes there, these poor Brazilians were completely shocked. Oh, this is how they look, but they don't look like on the coin, and they don't look like on the note. Anyway, they stay in Brazil for a long time, they loved it, they loved the weather. They didn't want to go back to Lisbon. And in fact, they had to finally force the king to come back. But the son, Dom Pedro, says, I'm not coming back, I'm staying there. And he started his own kind of kingdom in Brazil. Now what happens in that period, almost 10 years, okay, this takes, the British come to the Portuguese colonies and they also come to Goa. And when they come to Goa, they realize, they say, my God, look at this wealth, these big monuments in old Goa, the big churches and all this gold, where did they come from? Then they realize the secret, it came from opium. It came from opium, which at that time was like cigarettes or alcohol now. There was no shame in it, it was smoked widely. But it came from British India. So that made them angry and they said, how dare you take our opium from Calcutta and from here and Afghanistan, all the places that were British, and you sell it now to the Chinese and make all this money and become so rich. So when they were leaving, they took a whole bunch of Goans with them, because they felt that the Goans were already educated in the alphabet. They could read ABCD, which many Indians couldn't. Then they found that they were eating food that was very close to Portuguese food. They were eating beef and they were eating drinking wine and whatever. So they take two, three levels of Goans. One were the cooks and the butlers, and the maids, and the other was a higher ed, because the Portuguese were so happy with the Goans that they educated them, whether it was in Coimbra or elsewhere. They educated them, they made them advocates, they made them doctors, and they gave them top positions in diplomatic positions in all their colonies. They did not do that with any of the other colonies. You would not find an Angola person or a Mozambique person as an administrator in Goa. But in those places, you will find Goans still today who held very high positions. Now when they found the secret and they said, this is what is happening, that they are taking our opium, when they go back to Bombay after taking the first flood of Goans to Bombay and other places in their colony, they decide to open Bombay as the opium-free trade. They ask Mr. Faria from TV, please come and do this business now in Bombay. Mr. Faria says, I'm not coming, but you can take anyone who's working under me. There was one gentleman, Jamshedji Jiji Boy goes with the British to India, and there starts the wealth of Bombay. And he had a wife who was kind of sickly, and she lived in Bandra. This is just extra trivia. She lived in Bandra, and she had to take a boat to cross from Mahi to Bandra. So till today, we have to thank her, because she told her husband, we made so much of money, we're so wealthy, let's do something for the city. Let's connect this island of Bandra to Mahim. So they made a bridge, and they paid for the bridge, and they paid for the road. And till today, that road from Shivaji Park right up to Bandra station is called Lady Jamshedji. Now, after that, they started the opium wars, because the Portuguese were not happy to give away their business to China so easily. And they did the opium wars in 1930. That's when all these magnificent buildings in Bombay start to be built, because all that Rajabhai clock tower, the university building, everything starts to be built. Now, these Parsi people who stayed here, in my museum, we also have the old Pugdis and the Duglis and all, because there were lots of Parsis. And if you go through some of the illustrations of which the Portuguese did in the Goa University, there's a big archive of illustrations. You will see the Parsi gentlemen there with the other people who came to Goa to use as trade, from the Banyas to the Parsis, etc. Now, these Parsi ladies at that time began to wear, since they were working with the Portuguese, they did not want to show their midriff. So from Gujarat itself, they start wearing a longer choli, almost like a blouse, like the Goan Pano Bhaju, and long sleeves, or sometimes short sleeves, but and this Parsi Gara embroidery. This Gara embroidery comes from Persia, as I said, from Chakchak and Yaz, which are the oldest Parsi fires, which I have had the great opportunity of actually visiting the fire temple and praying in fires. And then the fire comes to Udwana in Gujarat. So they drape their sari in such a way that this Gujarati sells out. Next slide, please. So this is my friend Ashleen Lolia Wala. I hope I said it right. No,
Lilama.
Yeah. So Ashleen has very kindly donated one sari for my museum, and you will see it in the main exhibition, which happened from the 15th to the 22nd of December. It's a very beautiful sari. Now, as you can see, the embroidery of the motifs again is not. It can be done in two stitches. One is the Ari stitch, which is like a kind of a chain stitch, a very fine chain stitch. The older ones, because he gave me an old one, they have just the border, it's not all over like these new ones. So both that chain stitch and the Ari stitch come again from China and from Persia to us. Next piece. Somebody asked me, why this Persian connection? Do you know our earlier emperors, Mughal emperors, when they wanted to marry, they would marry somebody from Persia. So Jahangir's wife, she brings with her the embroidery, which is now in Lucknow, Pachkantan. And she bought all 40 stitches with her, and she starts to set it up her carts in India. And now today, the irony is that the Persians don't have it, but we have it. So that's how these threads keep moving. This is an older Gara, it's done all over. What is poignant also is that shawl which is on the chair. It appears like the dupatta of a Pano Bhaju. which pass women wear, and they made these what are called grand shawls. Means big enough shawls to wrap around yourself in the cold. That also comes to Goa and it features in the Pano. Next, please. The next place, we've already mentioned China, but if you look at the blouse or the what they call the Cheongsam, the Cheongsam blouse also is on the basis of the Pano Bhaju, but it is not exactly the exact basis. Our Pano Bhaju jacket is cut like a Mughal cut. We didn't have any cutting in this country until the Mughals arrived. Not Mughals, the first Muslims arrived, because they bought with them the art of cutting pattern pieces. Till then we had only drapes. But of course if you tell the writings, they're not happy. They say that we invented the kurta. We so did not. So this Cheongsam, next slide please. That's how it looks. If you look at the length of the blouse, you can wear it with a skirt, the length of the sleeve. It's all the same kind of length which the Pano Bhaju has, so that you can show off that certain amount of jewellery. The sleeve is cut a little bit shorter. And the length is also longer, not to show the midriff. Next please. Here is the man wearing a Cheongsam jacket with a skirt. Now skirts also were not that much seen, but we do start to see them, and this silhouette looks exactly like a silhouette of the Pano. So somebody must have seen it in China and decided that now when this mandoting starts, we will dress like this because it will please us and it will please the Portuguese. But we made it more opulent so that it looks richer. Also we think, next please. The next thing that is similar comes from Singapore, and they wear what is called a sarong kabaya. Kabaya is the blouse and sarong is for the skirt. Next slide. Now when you look at the sarong kabaya, it looks very beautiful. It has the same kind of lace effect which is worn inside the Pano Bhaju. The Pano Bhaju has an inside white gloves, normally white, and an outside jacket on top of it. If you look at the edging of this kabaya, it's beautifully edged and also has three very elaborate brooches to hold it in place. This also we will see in the exhibition that opens at the old cemetery. And it's worn with a sarong skirt. Next. Can you see the beauty of that lacy effect, almost a mixture of crochet and embroidery, which also is worn in Telma's Pano Bhaju. Next, please. Another place this could come from, this inspiration or influence could come from, is Burma. In Rangoon or Yangon or Myanmar as we call it now, they wear a garment that looks very similar to the Pano Bhaju garment. Next. Can you see those? That lungi drape, the stripes, and the blouse, this length of blouse again which appears. So we had a big connection with Burma. A very big connection. In fact, we have, I don't know if Yvonne is here. Is she here? No. Yvonne wrote a book on the Song of the Survivors, where she talks about how during World War II, hordes of Goan walked their way back to India via Calcutta. And they walked there. Till today, you go to Goan houses and they serve you the Burmese sausages. And we get this influence from Burma. Closer. Okay, next please. Can you see also the hair on the head? Is this looking a bit familiar? This drape of the dupatta, the length of that blouse and the skirt, and the flowers in the hair. But in Burma, they put real flowers in the hair. You will never see Aung San Suu Kyi or rose, an orchid or a flower in the hair, because that is their way of decoration. And if you look at old Goan jewelry, you will realize that it must have gone from fresh flowers to gold flowers or silver flowers, which will come up again in the hair. Next, please. So that's a Burmese lingerie. These are all fashionable girls. I think they are buying for Miss Burma. Next. Okay, then we have two Indian collections. This is called a pom skirt from Kohima, which is the capital of Nagaland. And this again, that entire northeast area wears this kind of a look. A lungi with a blouse and a dupatta. Next please. See, can you see what she's wearing? And these stripes going all over. So it can come from by land as well. Next please. See, the jewelry, the sarong skirt and the blouse, short sleeve blouse. Next piece. All can come from a chuttai, which is from Bangkok or the ancient kingdom of Siam, where we will see how their garment looks now. Very close to the Pano Bhaju. Next please. But in their own inimitable way, you will see this garment. We have actually got a copy, and I don't think we need to make a bench or anything. So this elegance, the slim elegance, but they pleat their lungi. They pleat their lungi, and because they have so much of silk, they make the entire thing in silk, not in velvet or not in any other kapda. It's always a nice silk. So next please. This is a very elaborate chuttai, but I put this sliding here because it comes from the royal family. They have a collection of garments and I got to see the garment. This drape which goes across the shoulder. We wear our dupatta with the Pano Bhaju straight and fix it the one throat. But this crossover drape happens again with a blouse inside and a sarong skirt. Next please. And then we have the Bhaju Kurung from Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia. Very interestingly, next slide. Very interestingly, it comes with a skirt of a kurta. We have got that also from there for us. And since it's a Muslim country now, they wear this dupatta on their head, or to cover their head. Next is. So this kurta becomes important later on for the Pano Bhaju. Because we don't cut the Pano Bhaju with a round armhole. It's cut like a kurta armhole. When you examine the piece, it's got a kurta panel and a gusset, a triangular gusset inside. And we have the garment and you see it again at the Ajusha Palace. So this is a kurta, full length kurta with a sarong skirt underneath. Next please. This is the most important reference which I think it could have come from. The Peranak in Chinese or the Baba Noinath or the straight Chinese way of the Malik in Spain, they were already a mixed people. They were mixed Chinese with Malay. They had no qualms about marrying the Portuguese men when they came to Goa. Portuguese Goan Brahmin girls refused to marry those sailors who came from there. Apart from the viceroy, everyone else came from lower class or they were official rights, which is the orphans of the king. But here what happens is that these women, if you go today to Malacca, and I've been there twice for this research, you will see the extremely tight similarity with the Pano Bhaju. Next slide please. So, this is a regular girl, not dressed to go out. Okay? She's wearing this kind of a long blouse, again a sarong, slightly transparent, and she wears a small piece of jewellery which we wear a lot of. But next slide. Look at this girl's jewellery. It's they say that Goan ladies will like to wear all their jewellery and go for mass. And it's true, some of them do, especially the ones from the lower class. They want to show it off. And they wear the entire jewellery box and go to church. But Hindu women also wear a lot of jewellery in their hair and everything. In a cupboard for the Peranakan, not cupboard, vitrine for the Peranakan Chinese costume, you will see the very elaborate kind of jewellery that they wear very close to the Pano Bhaju. Next please. This is the Bharat Saya from Manila, Philippines. I had no idea that there was going to be a connect here also in the Philippines, but I went to the archive person who is a very close friend of mine, and he showed me various Bharat Sayas. The Bharat Saya starts as a blouse and a lungi, and then gradually as the 1940s come, it morphs into a gown with butterfly sleeves. So we will see one example of a Bharat Saya here. Next slide please. See, can you see how it is? It's got this long kind of a satiny skirt or a sarong. Then it's got this shorter blouse but tightly fitted, and it's got these butterfly wings. They've added one thing. They don't wear what is called a stole or a fata like we have. They wear what is called a panuelo. And this panuelo is wrapped in this kind of a fichu collar style around the blouse part. It's not left to hang. Next slide. So that's how the fichu that Fishu Panwala looks. That's the blouse. Again, the same blouse length we're talking about, same sleeve length, and the skirt that's slightly A length. Of course, the great Mrs. Marcos wanted to revive that old style, and she was never seen in anything but a Baroque style. She went all over the world. She was a fashion plate. She was a Miss Philippines, and she did a lot. She's holding one more clue in her hand, which we also have in Goa. She's carrying an umbrella. Now, it would be impossible to dance a Pano Bhaju with a fan and an umbrella. But we still see people going out, and we don't call them umbrella. We say umbrella for the rainy season, but parasols in the hot summer season. So this parasol also is found all over the Far East. The umbrella is given to a person of dignity or importance, even for gods. If you go to temples, still today you find an umbrella on top of the main idol. But those are not collapsible. Like the fans become collapsible later. Fans definitely came from China, and there's no argument about that. And it came down to the entire Far East. They were fixed fans. They had like a bamboo stick and this oval type fan on it. Okay, next slide, please. This is another place that has something very similar to the Pano Bhaju. It's called the Chattamundu. And Chattamundus are worn specially in Cochin by Syrian Catholics. Because they did not want to wear a sari to go to church. So we have got that, this example as well. The Chattamundu is a draped sarong or lungi, if you want to call it that, and a blouse. It can be very simple and can be also very elaborate depending on the occasion. When they are going to church, they prefer to wear white. When they are going elsewhere, they wear their chattamundus in bright colors as well. But normally it's a white tone. Next slide, please. Can we see one? So she's wearing what's called a chattamundu. So short blouse, lungi down, and that kind of dupatta which is falling there. And when they go to church, they will wear a rosary on their necks. Not jewelry. But they can wear elaborate jewelry as well with the chattamundu. When they are getting married, they are packed with jewelry. Next please. So now we will look at finally the accessories, which you will see again in the old secretary. The accessories that go with the Pano Bhaju are remarkably close to the accessories in the entire Far East. Next slide please. Can you see them holding that fan? These are Baroque from the Philippines. But the fan is very integral. And also the umbrella becomes integral to them. This is a very early period, so you can see that the sleeves are extremely wide. The fichu is very big, but the blouse length and the skirt down stays the same. Next. Then they have these combs. These also come from the Philippines. Beautiful combs in silver, which are worn as hair combs with the Pano Bhaju. These ones, I have seen this one personally because it belongs to a friend of mine who works in the museum. And it is very elaborately done. It's not a regular flat comb like the lower one. We would wear more the ornamental comb. Sometimes the tortoise shell in those days, because it was not banned. The most expensive one, I am trying to get one from my museum and I can't get one, but if somebody gets one, I'll take it. So tortoiseshell combs, very popular for the Baroque style in the Philippines. Next please. These slippers, all the Parsis in the room will recognize it. So sapats. We spoke about the Parsi sapats. They are remarkably similar to our Pano Bhaju velvet slippers. I think our velvet slippers have a slight heel. Now, and ours are embroidered in gold. Next please. This is a beautiful sapat from the Philippines, again. Well, it's a velvet slipper, and the entire velvet slipper has a silver filigree kind of work on it. So we are getting more and more into this ornamentation which the Pano Bhaju eventually becomes. Next please. This comes from Indonesia. You know, in Goa, if you see Hindu ladies, especially in this fisher people community, the first time I read, one of my boys was getting married. And I was just amazed at the jewelry. And I found that they had this kind of a comb almost, gold comb. And the cone had these flowers that were fluttering, and I said, how is it moving like that? Each time they moved their head, it would catch the light. And when I looked closely and I asked one of the ladies, can I look at your hair comb? She put it up and she showed it to me. It's in my book, it's in my Moragua book. It actually had a small spring attached to the flower, and they call them halka phula, because they all shake. And this halka phula, now look at this. This is also remarkably close, because this is a hairpin, a decorative hairpin that you put into your big hairdo, which takes the part of the halka phula. Next, please. And then you have other combs, one from China, one from Vietnam, which also are ornamental, decorative in manner. Next, please. Look at these brooches. These also come from the Karnataka Chinese. It's that a garment which has three brooches. It's like our kurta buttons, but they put three brooches. And they wear a lot of gold. The Karnataka Chinese are known for their gold. When they come to Goa, finally, they bring with them also the dowry boxes that were round wood boxes. One of them is lying in the Ribandar Sola. What is it called? Yeah. They have one round, very Chinese, it's a red Chinese lacquer box. They should keep all their jewelry there. Sometimes they would also put all their dowry for their wedding in that box. And till today in Goa, they are called dowry boxes. So these three kind of pins, which are, if you look at it closely, the motif, where the diamonds are put, it looks exactly like a Goan piece of jewelry. You cannot tell the difference between ours and theirs. It has got the same flowers, the same leaf, and the same arabesque, which are complex. Next. And the fan. Somebody gave me this fan from Calcutta, and I'm ever grateful. I was looking out everywhere for a mother of pearl fan, and I didn't find it, and I posted it on Facebook. Finally, a designer called Shantanu Goenka posted me, not only the fan, but a very old antique parasol with a ivory handle. And the parasol is just about this small, and doesn't do much, but the handle is longer than the parasol itself. The handle goes on about this much, and the parasol is about that half. We will have that in the vitrine as well, and we can find it out searching for that. Next. And these always highly ornamented bags, if you have to carry a bag with a Pano Bhaju, it would match the outfit. It would be red velvet with beaded embroidery, or red velvet with gold embroidery on it, but always a very ornate bag. This bag is not used when you are dancing the mandor, it's kept with somebody else, so you can go and dance the fan. Next, please. Look at these shoes. These shoes are the Karnataka Chinese shoes. They are very beautiful. They are still available. I managed to get one in Singapore. They are beaded, and they have the same height of heel as the Pano Bhaju. Next, please. So, and that ends my talk. I will be open for questions. I hope you can see the difference now and the similarities as to how, when you actually see the exhibition, you see 12 pieces, full costume head to toe, because they have managed to get them all. And you will be amazed when you see them all together, how similar the Pano Bhaju is, and the fact that it definitely came partly from Persia, but most definitely from the Far East.